Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Gentlemen and ladies, non-binary folks.
Ladies and gentle them.
Babies and gentle them. Thems. They's. Those.
Everybody.
Word. Good evening, everybody. This is another episode of the Sex on Shuffle, just another podcast mashup. Mm-hmm. I am Just.Hek.
Peace, y'all. And I am Cindy Lee, your succulent sexologist, host of Sex on Shuffle.
A lot of S's. Awesome S's.
Alliteration.
So, ladies and gentlemen, tonight we have an interesting topic for y'all. I want to talk about ninth place medals. And I know what you guys are thinking, right? Like, ninth place medals. What the hell are you guys talking about? So what I'm talking about are the medals that are given out at competitions nowadays, where they're given to everybody, all the kids, all the people. And, you know, whether you came in first or last, you all get a medal, right? A very small part of me agrees with it because I get it. It's a very, very small part of me. but for the most part, number one, I totally disagree with it. I disagree with it for many different reasons. I get it. We want to be inclusive and we want to stop the bullying. And I get all that. I get that totally. I think part of the new generation and even part of our society today has been very proactive in stopping bullying. And I think that that's dope. I think a lot of the damage that was done to my generation was due to the bullying and due to how you had to handle it. Mm. You know, pretty sure a lot of people in my generation were made to fight people that were bullied, that bullied them. And some of those fights were probably unfair. Mm-hmm. You already had to go fight somebody that was twice your size, get your ass whooped. And it was like, right, but he's going to respect you. And that was like a 50-50 shot.
Mm. Right.
You know, depends.
What's the cost-benefit analysis of me getting my ass whooped?
Because you ain't going to be there all the time. you know, yeah, it was like a 50-50. Mm. Usually led to more violent acts. Where that's how you really got the respect. But needless to say, I get why competitions happen. But I do feel that there's a need for winners and losers. Okay. There's a need for it. Because in losing, I feel like losing is the greatest aspect of the competition. Because when you win, you just win. And you get the big trophy and the adulation, whatever. But the people who lose learn from this. They get a lesson out of that. What did they do that made them not come in first place? Okay. And I think that's part of why we have successful people, or not totally why, but, you know, when you look at like sports stars like Michael Jordan and Kobe Bryant, and, you know, and you look at, you know, Tom Brady, and you look at, I know, oh, not Tom Brady, because he's won a lot, but, you know, you talk about the guys that, the people that have, that you watched them lose before they became the greatest, you know, they are the greatest of their era. You know, Shaquille O'Neal, and I'm making a lot of basketball references because I follow basketball a lot more. But, you know, you look at, like, the Yankees in the 90s. They had to go through the Toronto Blue Jays. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, getting through them and then having to go through, you know, get to the World Series and play against an overmatched Atlanta Braves team that they ended up beating. because of their battles with the Toronto Blue Jays. Like, those losses prepared them to be great. And you know, I just feel like it becomes enabling. Like, there's no urge to be greater or to be better or to overcome those obstacles. Because if everyone just gets a medal, it's like, okay, well, I got a medal. And then you know, there's no really trying. And competition is healthy. There's nothing wrong with competition. The fact that we've taken the bullying out of it makes competition even greater, because now you see guys and when, you know, you see people saying, you know, being congratulating and saying, yo, listen, you know, you didn't get it this time, but maybe next time. You know what I'm saying? People, it wasn't like when I was coming up and you didn't come at first, you just get shitted on. It was like, yeah, okay, whatever. Right. Don't talk to me. You're a loser. It was like, damn.
Yeah.
We was just cool. So, you know, I think that when you remove that, that's what makes the competition even better now, because people learn without the fear of being told that you're lesser than. You know, if we were doing this 20 years ago, it might have made sense, even though it couldn't exist 20, 30 years ago. It just couldn't because we were too hard back then. But, you know, I don't know. What are your thoughts, Cindy?
I'm so interested. I have so many questions. I'm trying to keep it all together because it's so, you know, I forget 20 years ago was 2000. So let's just say that first, like I was in high school,
right?
And I will say, out of my experience, I used to play ball and I would get I forgot what it was called, but it was like a participation trophy, right? It was smaller. It wasn't that I won a thing or that I was most whatever player. It was like whatever it was called, because it was another flowery term. It's still, I understood it at my age,
right?
That this is just you being polite, right? So I understand those points, and I don't give a fuck, right? Like, I think my pieces are, because I always look at the system piece, right? And I know, but I want, you know, listen, invite it for a second. I'm more concerned with the messaging and with the trusted adults in the scenario, because I automatically think young people, because that's when I got those kind of awards. I don't know how it works for collegiate or whatever.
No, you don't get participation medals at that level.
Right. So like, yeah. I figure.
So that's with the young people,
So I get why people have pushback, because people are connecting the sensitivities of young people, or the fact that young people may or may not, at least in their experience, have some type of driver initiative. I think that's not tied to awards alone, right? Like, and when I say I don't give a fuck, it's in my head, I'm like, ooh, what do I talk about? Like, what is my opinion about this? And I immediately, like, I don't care about the trophies except the fact that they're wasteful, like in terms of like the earth dying, and I don't know if these trophies are biodegradable.
That's what I'm saying. Think about so many of them.
Right. Like, I think I just in my 20s and 30s had thrown mine out, even though I did not win. It was participation trophies, except for like the team ones. I think because I didn't have it, so I know this is coming from a place of like my own stuff, I would have rather had adults that told me, these were the things you were good at, these were the things I want you to improve on, because I want you to want better for you.
Right.
So that I could have that mind frame and that mindset earlier about that, like, be in competition with yourself, right? Like, be better than you were. Right. Because I can get competitive, which is probably why I don't like competition too much, because I don't know how I can wrangle myself around that shit. Mm-hmm. But there was a point I was saying it, bring it, come back. I think the it's gone. I was looking for it. Sometimes, hey, you know, yeah. Divergence is a beautiful thing. Hey. I think, what was the big piece? Going back to the adults and the projections that I feel that that adults project onto young people around feelings of not enoughness, around whether or not someone is valuable, regardless of what they produce. Because I think about, you know, Black and brown kids, and they get whatever accolades they get if the teachers think that that is a skill, right? But then we ignore all the other skills they have. Right, without taking it too tangential, because you know I'll go out there and we'll start talking about, you know, systemic oppression. Right. But that's that. But that's how I receive it, because you know,
it's a part of it. It's a small part of it. Definitely.
I would love for my young people to get accolades, period. Let alone right. And I would also not like it for us to find more ways to put comparison. And I know it's like age development matters. So I feel like I'm cool. Young people at the stages where they want that affirmation and that validation, give that. And also to me, that's surface level, like a trophy is surface level. Tell the young person what they need to work on. Show that you give a fuck about that person bettering, or be okay with the fact that they don't want to play this sport. Like, it's because I'm watching young people play. I'm going to my nephew's basketball practices. So it made me think about that, because I think about how so many, they're young people. So like babies, right? Maybe like 10 and under. Yeah. Some have the technical skills already, right? Some you could tell they just want to be there to have fun because there's nothing else that exists. And then some are like completely like, I don't even know what I'm doing here. I'm gonna run with the ball because it's fun. Yeah. Fuck that, it's a travel, right? Like, so there's this combination of different experiences. And I always look at them and I feel like, damn, what's gonna happen when they grow older, right? Like, are they gonna be forced into playing this game? Or are they gonna be forced into practicing it so much that they hate it? Like some of my closest people, like they didn't even go to college for basketball because of how much they put it on them. And I'm sure it came from a good place. I'm not shading parents, because sometimes it's because we want better for them and we want them every opportunity. And of course, if it's, you know, something that has to do with athletics or, you know, whatever they're into, whatever passion, cool. Yeah. And I'd like to see much more than that. So if you told me everybody got a trophy, okay, and what are you going to do with the folks that you don't think are going to be better next year? Are you letting folks enjoy this shit? Or get the skill, or be an actual coach and give them whatever tools? Or are you just gonna be like, look, I did this thing, this was volunteer anyway, fuck it. Like, and what that's how that shows up.
Yeah, definitely. And that's kind of what those participation trophies take from people. It takes the onus off of you having to develop kids into, you know, either in being a, you know, because I mean, identifying who's going to be good and who isn't, you can kind of see that based on what you're, you know, the what's going on with the young person and their talent. But those participation trophies, to me, take away the onus from the adults and saying, you know, listen, you know, just go out there, have fun, or, you know what I'm saying? Because in the end of the day, it also misleads kids to me, it misleads young people to where not everyone wins in life. You know what I'm saying? Like, there isn't no, you know, you go into the real world or you, when you start, when you get into the teenage years, not everybody wins. And it becomes harder. And if you've been getting participation trophies all this time, you're kind of being misled to say, oh, well, I won. Then when the competition becomes stiffer and you gotta push, you ain't really developed that. You didn't develop that in the younger stages because those things weren't, you know, and that's not to say, you know, it's, you know, and there was something that you brought up where you were like, well, you don't necessarily need the trauma to be better, or maybe, you know, the what if.
Yeah.
And it's just a what if to me, mm-hmm. at least. You know what yeah. I'm saying? Because there is some trauma that goes into everything. And trauma is gauged within each person. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Your trauma isn't mine, and vice right. versa. And that losing to some kids, that's everything. It's like, oh my God. Like I got a cousin-in-law who has a daughter that is super like competitive. Mm. That we were at his house. Shout out to Tarrytown, beautiful place. You know what I'm saying? And we're in his backyard. He's got a beautiful house. We're in the backyard. He's really into like sports. He's into basketball. I'm in a podcast with him. Shout out to Ed Dallas, mm-hmm. Ed Montolio. And he's got the kind of basketball hoop where you shoot it, you make it in, it drops down and shoots it back at you. He's got that for his daughter
yeah. because,
to help her practice. And he right. bought that like during the pandemic.
Oh, wow.
And he's doing well for himself, to say the mm-hmm. least. But, you know, we're shooting and I'm, you know, I start messing with her, as I yeah. do everybody. I start messing with her. And all of a sudden it became like, her eyes just like, oh. And I made four, she made five. Oh, I made five. I made six, she made four. Oh, like, you know what I'm saying? And so that trauma for her is pushing her.
Yeah.
But that doesn't work for every personality.
Right, right.
And sometimes as the adults that are really coaching will look at trying to see what will push the child. Because not everybody pushes the same way.
Right.
Some people have to figure it out on their own. Some people, if you push, they pull back. Right. You know, and to me, again, when you talk about ninth place medals, it's kind of like, it's a cool thing.
Mm.
But for me, it just, number one, it's way too much plastic. It's way too much plastic. Number two, you know, where are the adults in this process? Where are the parents? Yeah. Where are the coaches? Where are the, mm-hmm. you know, the uncles and the families that's supposed to uplift these children that didn't get first place or didn't, you know what I'm saying? You know,
yeah.
maybe that's all they care about, you know, and that's great too.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. I just feel like they're just really misleading and life gets tougher.
Yeah.
Regardless of anything, until the revolution happens, things are just gonna, things, especially when you get into like junior high school and you remember those changes.
Yeah.
The first, you know, seventh grade, I saw a pregnant girl and I'm like, why is your belly so big?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I'm pregnant, stupid. I'm like, oh shit, you're pregnant. Yeah. Seventh grade, I was like, wow, okay. Like, you know, and then that everything, you know, competition, the basketball, it was fun, but it was a different kind of fun. It was like people going at your head for real. Right. It was like, okay, you know, you catch an L, you come back, boom.
Right.
You know, and it was, that's basically, you know, and at least, and we're talking about like sports.
Yeah.
And, you know, but even in like, I mean, let's be real. Do you want the best surgeon? Or do you want the ninth best surgeon? Which one do you want performing surgery on you? Do you want the best one? Or do you want the ninth best one? Keep it a buck, Cindy. Keep it a buck.
I want...
You're dead.
No. Here's the thing. Like, this is where I think too much, but I'm okay with that. Like, I live with that. I think it's my immediate question is, what is the criteria? Because the best surgeon might chipe it up good, but then you are anti-Black, ain't shit, you won't kill me anyway, right? You're gonna be like, oh, they could take the pain. Don't worry about drugging them. Like, I think about all those things at the same time. So I'm like, what are the requirements? What's your roster? When you say best, is it because they went to this school? Because this school still got buildings named after enslaved folks, right? Like, I think about that. But you're right. Like, I do want somebody who's competent in their skill. And I think that's why it goes back to development. Because now, you know, I'm a sexologist. So I'm always going to think about sex. Period, right? Even before sexology, I'm a pervert. So I'm thinking about, like, there has to be a study around the medals, right? Participation or competition or competitiveness, and adults who want validation around sex or can't communicate or think that orgasm is the goal. And when they don't get that orgasm, like, they don't make their partner orgasm, or they don't orgasm themselves, that they feel like they missed the mark, right? They feel like a loser, because again, we're not having the conversations, or we're talking about them in one piece and right. not seeing the connection to all of it. Cause it automatically makes me think, you want to be you want competition? Cool. Be competitive. If that's your joy, I'm here for it. And if it's not, I want you to be validated too in that, right? Like, the same way you got that homie that did that, that has that fancy batting range kind of basketball, who I think that's a beautiful thing. And I wish I had adults in my life that supported me in that way. Yeah. And I have family members who had adults in their lives that supported them and rocked the hoodies. And they knew before they even applied to college, they were like, I'm not doing ball. And you know, I don't want to project my shit onto them, but in my head, I'm like, damn, why? You're so good. You got championships. You got this, this, and this. Mm-hmm. I think I want so much more for you. And that's my personal shit. I'm not going to put that onto the person, right? Like, they're 17 now. I'm not going to put that onto them, because that's my version of success. And to them at that point, success was like, I'm tired. I've had my whole high school career where I did all this shit.
Yeah.
Right, got all these trophies, but it made me lose the love for the game. I don't want to fucking play no more. Right. And honoring that part too. I think there's gonna be an ask for every toilet seat. There's gonna be people who didn't get medals and feels like that is what made them into the resilient person that they are. And I want my young people to not have to deal with resilience, right? In an ideal world, I don't want them to have grit to be able to live in this world, regardless of the fact that, like you said, you want to put them in a position where it's realistic and you're not going to get ninth place medals, even when you're first place for a lot of us. And that's the fucked up part, that you're trying to, like, keep it 100 for them so that they're not set up for failure, right? So I feel like there's a way that we can honor all of those truths and, you know, it's our responsibility as people who give a shit about young people. If you give a shit about young people.
Definitely. It also sounds too like communication is the key though. Like, okay, like if we talk about like grownups, and let's talk about like insects, right?
Yeah.
If you don't feel like you're satisfying your partner, if your partner's not satisfying you, and you're in a relationship. For more than like sex,
yeah,
then communication has to be the thing. You know what I'm saying? Right. And that alleviates the participation medal,
right?
And being like, oh yeah, that was cool. When really you're like, no, I came out of this with nothing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I this wasn't good for me. Explain that. Just, you know, like explain it. Communicate in a manner that's not abusive. Or a manner that isn't putting your partner down.
Mm-hmm.
And then that goes back to anything. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If you communicate, if you say, listen, child. You know what I'm saying? I'm not gonna put a gender or anything. Listen, child. Yeah. You know, you did good.
Yeah.
You did well, but these are the things that we need to work on with you.
Yeah.
And you say key things like we.
Yeah.
No, we need to work on this.
Right.
Because when you say we, that person isn't on an island. That means that we're all together in this, in your development. And does that happen enough nowadays? I think it happens more now than when I was growing up, or even when you were growing up.
Right.
When I was growing up, it was like, yo, you need to go work on your free throws. You know what I'm saying? Go figure that out. Come back next Thursday. We got a game over here. You know what I'm saying? Meet us over here. In fact.
Yeah.
You know, so it's different, but I think communication would alleviate the need for participation medals because, you know, to me, a lot of the children don't even really value them, to be honest with you. Mm. I mean, you get some that are like, and I get there are some that love it because of the fact that they know that they may not be able to compete at the same level as their peers. And it may be due to like, you know, a mental health issue or a physical issue, you know what I mean? And you get those moments and you've seen them on Instagram or YouTube where you got the person with like with spina bifida, or, you know what I'm saying? Or someone, you know, has a mental health disability and they get to play and that's everything. Because at the end of the day, they don't care win or lose. They want to just be a part of it. Where they don't feel like the outcast, but they know these things. They know something sets them apart from the other children. And those are the times where I'm like, no, definitely. But in the overall scheme of things, when the playing field is leveled and you have children or you have people that are able to compete.
Yeah.
And it just comes down to who's prepared more. Who's willing to go that extra mile? No, you got to reward that because the children that prepare and really wanted it, those are the, you know what I'm saying? That means something. They went out of their way. They did their homework. They did their chores. Yeah. They did everything they need to do. Or, you know, they're surviving a shitty household.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they made it to this game. And they came and they won. And they, you know what I'm saying? They deserve to have that moment. Because it goes, it's both sides too. Because sometimes you can lessen the value of the first place when that really matters to that kid. And it's not to say that first place should matter. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, if you prepared hard, great. But, you know, in competition, there's only one winner. And we have to be okay with that. You know what I'm saying? Like there can't be everybody won. No, everybody did win. You know what I'm saying? Like, when Usain Bolt beats you, he won.
Right.
By a lot, mind you. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Second is a distant second. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But you know, and you take solace in the fact, listen, I lost. Same goal. You know what I'm saying? Or when you lose, all the dudes that lost to Mayweather. Right. I lost to Mayweather. Like, can't, you know what I mean? I lost to greatness. It happens. You know, it is what it is. You know, and I don't see, you know, outside of the lingering social structures that created this kind of dichotomy or whatever. Yeah, I get that. I totally get that. You know, but we wouldn't have, to me, in all honesty, the Obamas and the Jordans and, you know, a lot of these people came out of that. And, you know, we have to be tougher because the world isn't a better place yet. This world isn't, you know what I mean? It was still like, you know, I'm gonna keep it a buck. Like, I work for two white guys are my boss, but I'm the one that manages all the people of color. You know what I'm saying? Just to keep it straight, do I have a chance on stepping over them? Maybe, but it's a stretch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I gotta look at whether what I'm gonna invest my time into that. Into you know, all the weird things that go on outside of that. And then two, you know, like, is this what I really want? So you know, and that's life. that's life. You know what I mean?
So yeah.
I don't know. You know, it is what it is.
I think multiple truths can exist. And I think that's okay too. Cause I know sometimes, you know, we don't have to be for or against the thing
give me an example of multiple truths existing for one thing.
So, all right. So for example, let's see if I won't go too tangential. When you have mentioned folks with like disabled folks, mm-hmm. right? Disabled folks being mm-hmm. able to play Special Olympics, right? To me, for some people that may feel like a caveat, but that's a justice issue, right? Like that's an access issue because there's so much ableism in this world that we can't have these disabled kids play with the quote unquote non-disabled kids because there's such a difference because we are still in competition mode around who is the best of the best because some of us, there are folks who are in these positions of power that still believe in Darwinism, right? Like still believe in survival of the fittest, still believe that the myth of meritocracy, that this fake ass lie that we're given, that all we gotta do is work hard and we'll be successful when we know that that's bullshit. So I feel like sometimes, and I'm curious for people who fuck with competition and that drives them, I'm curious of how that shows up for folks because what I've seen is I can get competitive, but it doesn't take me to a good place, right? It makes me want, like I think about when I used to play Nintendo, right? Like I get so aggravated, I hit, you know, my cousin by accident. I was so mad and I'll thank you.
Those joysticks hurt.
It's what is our mindset around what is winning, right? And I think that shows up in our shit too, which is why everything is so fucked up when we think about like what's quality and what's quantity. And that's why I think it shows up in all these places. So like for you to have a position of power where you are leading people and managing folks, right? Like that's a win for folks. And yet in that truth, you still have to deal with powers that be that aren't in alignment with you. That could, it could risk your job, even if you're right. Even if what you're saying is just and the right thing to do. If they were like, I don't know if you fit the company culture, you out. And that's it. And that's where these multiple truths can exist because it's that mindset thing. It's that, what is this teaching you? Because I do think failure is necessary for us, right? We can't just not witness failure or not let our young people feel failures because what that does is that ignores whatever feelings they have. And that message is, oh, just eat that. You'll be good. It's fine. You like, and it's no, let's be upset about this thing, like you said. And let's talk to the young person. Let's be like, how did you think you did? Right? Like, what would it look like for us to not even make the assumption about our critique? What if it was the young person didn't want your fucking critique because they don't want to play NBA, right? Like they just play a CYO, like whatever it is. And then there's some that want that. Give me that fever on their own. And I think that's, again, it's the whole one size doesn't fit all, right? One situation is not going to fit because I don't know. A part of me feels like that competitive nature was instilled from like other things. For us to want to be a us against them, it sounds like those characteristics of white supremacy. And I know that's not what we're talking about, but that's all I think about, right? Because
sex. It could have some roots from slavery, possibly.
I'm sure, but even in just white supremacy at all, the fact that we have to be competitive, right? Think about where competition is in other places, that we think we have to be the best of the best in order to obtain an education. That's bullshit. That should be available to everybody, right? When we think about, when I think about competition, sometimes I think about the things that people can't have.
The opportunity, right?
Right.
Definitely.
The opportunity and the access and the opportunity for you to have beliefs that you are worth something regardless of what you put out there, regardless of what you could do for your school or for your parents or for your parents' ego. Like I want this to be able to like what is this bringing you joy? And I know my mindset is different from what it was maybe 20 years ago, but like, does it feel good to do this? Do you like to be competitive? That's why I don't want to say I'm anti-competition, because if that fuels you in a way that's healthy, in a way that feels good for you, that isn't harming people, then I want you to live your fucking best life. But if you are getting mixed messages around that, how does that show up in other places? Right? I'm thinking about, I get to sex, but I'm like, how many of these people that are so competitive in other spaces take that competition and put it in unhealthy ways in other spots? Right? What does it look like to say, now I'm thinking about a lot of cishet dudes, not everyone, y'all, but I'm like, a lot of cishet dudes that didn't have an understanding of what sex and sexuality meant. And put that competitive nature into that and thought quantity was better than quality and had sex with tons of people or had lots of sex capes that they can talk about. But when the skill came down to it, they didn't have a skill because they thought all they had to do was put it in like a thermometer, right? I feel like all of this stuff is connected and I just want y'all to live your best lives without having to shit on somebody. And to also, I get that, to recognize when you are doing good and when you are having accomplishments.
No, totally. No, I don't know. I just, you know, without it being such a negative thing, right? And I got episode 4 playing in the background. But without it being such a negative thing, because it isn't. You know, it's not, I get the purpose of it.
Yeah.
It's just at some point, you know, it's like if you have the child that you know is that this may be a sport for them, and then you have to figure out ways to kind of motivate them to you know what I mean, to practice and all those things. I don't know. I just feel like you have some of these events are just like, they're just misleading for children. And what you do is you end up when these children get to the age where they're out in the world on their own. And that happens very early. It's not like 18, 19, you're in the world. No, that just starts when you're like 11, 12 years old.
Yeah.
And you're on that bus by yourself, you know, by yourself.
Yeah.
And you have to fend for yourself because you're dealing with other children who come from different ideologies. And you know, and it is what it is. It's, you know, part of nature is bullying in a sense. Yeah. You know, you have the predators and you have some kids that they know, okay, well, I'm bigger than half of these kids on this bus, so I'm gonna be the person, whatever. And so, you know, and they start getting out there on their own and they start realizing, damn, I got all these medals and I was told I was great and maybe I'm not so great. And then now you have to like come back and be like, damn, well, no, it wasn't to say that you weren't great.
Right.
But, you know, and then it's like, well, you lied to me. Right. And then, you know, now it's like, oh, well, I didn't intentionally lie to you. We just wanted you to have a good time. And it was right. Like, right. But, you know, maybe you should have just said, you know, we could have did this a different way.
Yeah.
And, I could have been more prepared when I'm on my own than having to deal with these feelings and then look at you and feel betrayed. And then go home and like, you know, and deal with these feelings. And when you're like, when you're young, you don't really know how to process those things except to feel hurt and feel anger. And so, you know, you the person that's closest to you is the one that feels that first.
Yeah.
Which is your parents. And you're like, oh, you lied to me. And then it becomes a whole big thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know. It's, I think.
Yeah. I think we can't foresee the impact, right? And I think that's why as parents and trusted adults, it feels like a very gray, shaky place because you don't know how they're going to take it. But that's what it is. We don't know. I think that's part of the lived experience. We don't know how folks are going to take it. They're not going to take it the same way that you do. So you got to think outside of yourself in terms of how you view things and understand that fucking context matters, right? Because you'll have to explain to that young person, no, you were good. You still are good, but now you have a larger pool of folks and they're competing for this. So now it's just competitive here, but it's competitive for maybe a spot on the team, right? There's so many different things. So be able to speak about those things instead of making the assumption, oh, they're a kid, they don't get it, right? See where their head is at. So that they don't have to wait until they're older to get some of the messages and the teachings that would have been helpful as a young person, but people were like, oh, you're too young. And now that you're an adult, people expect you to be an adult, but there's some things you ain't fucking unpack or handle, which is why I tie it to sex sometimes, because that'll show up if you sit here and think you are deserving of a ninth place medal in every scenario, but you ain't worked for it. So I understand the nuance. And I'm still going to talk shit about whatever. That's all.
No, listen, ain't nothing wrong with it.
That's
all. It's nothing wrong with it. I just, again, like, you know, I think what we covered tonight, and I think the most important thing is communication. And it's probably, you know, at some point you have to do it, because children are a lot more alert than what you think. You know, and even the thought of like, oh yeah, you know, you have to keep them as children as long as possible. To a certain extent, yeah. But at the same time, they're also processing things. And there's this thing called the internet that's super, you know what I'm saying? That
available.
Super available on your phone.
From the womb to the tomb.
You know, on the computer, on your watch, in some sense. So, I mean, you know, it's like, who are you protecting? The child or you?
Right.
Really what it comes down to.
Real shit.
I mean? Like, you know, and if you're doing it for you, then shame on you, because really it comes from a selfish place. And I'm not saying that the ninth place medals come from a that's not what I'm trying to convey, but it's like, you know, I think we as people, as the adults, need to be better and not necessarily, you know, and it's not, I'm not condemning ninth place medals, but I think it's situational.
Yeah.
I don't think, you know, because when you get older, they're not giving out participation trophies like that. You know what I'm saying? AAU, it's only one winner.
Yeah.
And Pee Wee football is only one winner.
Yeah.
You know, like as you go up in competition, there's only one winner. You know what I'm saying? Like shit. When Jordan beat the Lakers in 91, Magic Johnson didn't get a second place trophy. He caught a nice L. Clyde Drexler in 92. Caught a nice L and then had to hear about it the whole summer during the Olympics. Because they were on the dream team together.
Right. But you made it to the Olympics.
Right.
Right? Like you getting shit from people who have never even tried. Right? That's a whole other thing. They took away the joy from what it means to be up there. Be like, oh, you got bronze. Okay. I made it to the Olympics. Yeah, right? Like,
you know. You know, but everybody, you know, to a certain extent, you know, like all these guys that lost, when they lost to Jordan, like, you lost to Jordan. Like, I mean, shoot, you ain't lose to like Christian Laettner, or like, you know, you ain't lose to nobody. You lost to the one of the best ever. I'm cool with that. You know what I'm saying? You know, and shoot, there's about 40, 50 Hall of Famers that didn't get a ring in the 90s because of Jordan. Like, shit happens. It happens. You know, I think we have to learn that losing, the losing isn't the destructive piece. It's how we're conveying that to the young people.
Absolutely.
You know, if you're coming off, they lose and you're like, you ain't shit. Huh. Of course.
Yeah.
Now you're creating a monster. And you need to sleep with one eye open. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I don't know. I think the onus is, you know, it's protecting the parents more than anything else. Mm-hmm. You know? And it's,
yeah.
Because, you know, you get older and it's like, I got all these trophies. Oh, did you get first place? Nah, I just showed up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There's no value in that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I don't
know. And look, I'm not throwing shade at the trophy industry. However, I don't know the history of trophies, but what if it has to do with capitalism in the sense of, I wasn't giving the kids trophies, so the parents stopped coming and they wasn't paying for them to come no more. So now let's make sure everybody gets a trophy, mm-hmm. because they're going to be like, I'm not going to pay these dues no more. And then I don't got a gig, right? Like, you don't know the connections to it, but it goes back to what you said. What's the message in the losing? Did you mm-hmm. say they lost, they suck? Or did you say, look, I want to work more with you on this? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Look, you was rocking it with this. I'm going to move you to this position, yep. right? Like, mm-hmm. well, how did we work with that?
Yep.
And it gets iffy because a lot of folks, you know, I tip my hat to a lot of the coaches. A lot of them do a volunteer, right? Or yep. poorly paid.
Yep.
So I get that those these layers.
Yeah.
But yeah, I know we said a lot about things, but that's the point of our conversations, because the podcast episode could be, oh, you know, what's our feelings around ninth place medals? Mm-hmm. But we know that in real life, there's more layers to that. There's more pieces. It impacts different parts of us, which is why we got parents that are really mad about a game when we know they're five. Like, right. you really upset and they're like,
right.
Word. Good game to my best friend, right? Like, however they saw it.
100%. You know? Well, Cindy, this wasn't as volatile as I thought it would be.
See?
No, but I had to like temper it. I had to like, because I was just gonna come out shooting. And I said, wait a minute, that's not gonna come off. You know, the message isn't gonna come off properly. I'm just gonna sound like a bad rapper.
Do it.
Ninth place medals ain't shit. You ain't shit.
Tell them why you mad.
Tell them why you mad. Stupid ass ninth place medals. No, I actually, I was at dinner and I asked my wife. I said, "Do you believe in ninth place medals?" She said, "No." And then I said, "Well, why don't you believe in ninth place medals?" And then she broke down why she didn't. She felt, you know, they don't really mm-hmm. push you to want to win. They don't really push you to want to achieve,
mm-hmm.
you know. And I said, "Okay, thank you. I found my place where this needs to come from."
Mm-hmm.
And she was like, "Oh," and she was like, "Why?" I was like, "Well, that's because the podcast tonight, that's what we're going to talk about." And
yeah.
I needed a place where to come from, because I'm coming from a bunch of different angles, and I'm not,
yeah.
this needs to be conveyed in a way where I'm, you know, where I'm not necessarily getting at youth, because mm-hmm. it isn't about them, you know,
right.
I want them to enjoy everything as possible yeah. until they get older. Look yeah. at the little doggy.
He would get a ninth place medal. Okay. He would get, you know what? You came to every practice, even though you slept. You made it, right? And I would be proud of him, because that's a commitment.
That's a commitment to come to practice.
Even though you slept, you what? You chose to go and not sleep in your comfy bed. So we could talk about that. Anyway, go ahead.
Man. Definitely. But definitely appreciate you tonight. I know you was really busy today doing your thing. So I appreciate you, you know, taking the time out to get this done. Now I can kind of like, you know, this will air when it needs to air.
When it needs to.
It'll be marvelous. But as always, you know, shout out to everybody who watched. Everybody who's going to listen, appreciate mm-hmm. you guys. Who are you again? Who are you?
Your succulents in some other spaces and places, but because context matters, I am Cindy Lee, your succulent sexologist, host of Sex on Shuffle.
That's right. And I am Just.Hek, host of Just Another Podcast. And this has been another mashup episode of Sex on Shuffle meets Just Another Podcast, SOS. /Japs.
First medal.
First place. No ninth place. First no place. Ninth.
All day.
Peace out, everybody. Much love. Blessings. Have a great night, y'all.
Shimmies.
Shimmies. Waiting for that. Best part of the podcast.